as digital agents in banking. And for sure, we are already in the age of big data. Within just 1 minute, we're producing 700,000 Google queries, sending 500,000 Facebook posts. We move around, we go shopping, all that produces data. A hell of data. And so the question comes up, can we now know everything? Can we understand the human body, brain, and personality? And of course, many scientists and engineers and business people and politicians get excited about this, and for good reasons also. We've already arrived in a new world, and that is characterized by a new currency. Data is the new oil. Why? Because now the most valuable companies in the world are not anymore oil companies, but data companies. But not only do we have a new currency, we also have a new economy, and this is called the attention economy. The scarcest resource in some countries doesn't seem to be any more money. It's our attention. So basically, our attention is being sold to companies in some markets. And if we can get your attention, basically, you can be influenced to buy certain kind of goods, to change your opinion. And this is interesting for the economy and also for politics. And that's also why a lot of the debate is now moving towards fake news and so on, because maybe the truth is not always the most interesting thing to tell. We also are living in a new legal system. We haven't noticed for a long time. Code is law. It means algorithms determining what can be done and what cannot be done, but those laws are not passed by a parliament. But they are still creating new laws of our society that basically are added to the natural laws. There are also new business challenges. And of course, now everybody wants to build a Silicon Valley. Switzerland wants to do that. Germany wants to do that. That's fine, but it's not easy. Because if we look into the data, we find that the world's largest IT companies are located in the United States and in China, but in Europe there is nothing. We look into the world's largest internet companies, the situation is not much different. So, most companies in the United States, some in South Korea and in Japan. And as we came to software companies, oh, that's much better. In fact, so there's one company, SAP, in Europe, but it's also largely US controlled and owned. Now, I think we need to realize that we're behind in terms of the digital revolution. We compare what's going on in Europe to the Silicon Valley, to China, to South Korea. So we're a few years behind, but the evolution goes exponential. Can we catch up? That will not be easy, because even if we were able to invest as much venture capital, if we had as many, as well-educated people who would work as hard as in the Silicon Valley, and we would accelerate at the same pace, then still, because of the exponential nature, the separation would grow. We have to realize that, and so Europe needs to have a different strategy, and we'll come to this later on. Now I'd like to ask, where is the digital revolution going? And here we can basically read this quote of the then CIA director Gus Hunt, who said, it's really very nearly within our grasp to be able to compute on all human generated information. And probably have no idea how much information that actually is. You are already a walking sensor platform. few examples that may be not so familiar. So, motoring cars are spying on you, reporting your weight, the food you eat, and a lot more stuff like the locations that you visit and so on. The NSA is now able to find your voice based on a personal voice profile. Figure out where you are, what you say, who you're talking to, and what. Also, our homes are not protected anymore. They are being delivered by those gaming engines, by smart TVs, at least that was for some time, even by smoke detectors, shockingly, and you have one in your sleeping room. Then also your cleaning robot might report data. These are just a few examples that may have not been so aware of. But in the meantime, there are companies that you usually don't know by name, that know what you think and know you better than your friends and family. And so there is a personality profile that has been secretly created about every one of us. And it's highly detailed and it's being used in order to shape marketing and advertisement to tailor it to your personality to be most effective. So we're being manipulated with personalized information. And this is not only done for the sake of marketing, it's also being used by modern politics. And Google has actually control centers, as Tristan Harris has reported, that are trying to manipulate the public discourse. So this is mass mind control. Tristan Harris has worked in one of those control rooms. He has reported about it. Very interesting. So Google wants to reprogram the state. It's not just by software and operation system for computers or smartphones, but for entire societies. And it's not the only companies. So all big IT companies, Apple and IBM, are trying to do that. And that was probably too critical. So the question is, could society be run like a giant machine? Right? Fascinating idea. So we would all be part of that giant machine, and so basically companies would try to figure out how these parts of it, how we work, right, and how we can be manipulated and controlled. And that actually works to some extent, but I personally believe that society is much more than a machine. It's much more than a giant supply chain. It's also not a giant entertainment park. In fact, cities, for example, in which we live, are places of creativity, of innovation, of learning, of meeting people, of communication, of co-creation. And so that is not taken on board in this model. But for sure, with digital technologies, we can build different kinds of digital societies, and we must choose. And that requires public dialogue, and we should have the say in people, right? It's not difficult these days to build a new kind of fascism, a big brother world, a very new world. In fact, we're all living in surveillance societies, let's be honest about it. Now, one of the features of some of those societies, not every country has officially implemented that, is free crime. That means algorithms are being used in order to detect possible wrongdoing and separate such people from places of influence where they can produce any harm. It even goes so far that in Great Britain there is a karma police program. It's not just interested in whether you would one day steal a car or do a burglary or something like that, but this program is interested in your personality. reality, what kind of movies you see on the internet, what kind of music you listen to. So everyone is being judged, right? This is a judgment day kind of scenario, one would say. And the problem is, somehow, a lot of this is based on spurious correlations, right? Such as this one. Number of serial killers is a function of chocolate consumption. So, if that was true, then everyone who eats a lot of chocolate might be taken in custody. Now, this is just a funny example, of course, but the point is that we really need to take care that we are not turning correlations into laws, right, which restrain society in its evolution. And in fact, it has been said by people leading AI at Google that killer robots is not the biggest problem, actually a bigger problem is bias. And it occurs every day. So a machine bias, for example, against people of color, or women, and of course, such kinds of bias should be avoided. But just imagine that becomes part of the coding of our society. Yeah, so we really have to pay attention. Another kind of society that we could build with all that data is communism 2.0. That means something like a benevolent dictatorship, government that believes to know what's best for its country and its citizens and enforce that. And such a thing is happening at the moment in China, where they have a test project for social citizen score, where similar to the current police project, everything people do and don't do would potentially get plus or minus points. So even if you don't visit your grandmother frequently enough, if you cross the street when there's a red light anyway, if you pay your rental fees late, that would all give you minus points. But also if you read critical political news, or if you have friends who read critical political news, and then your citizen score will determine what kind of jobs you can get, what countries you can travel to, even whether you can use public transport or not, and how fast your internet is. Yeah. So this is, of course, totalitarian in nature, and by the way, it also introduces feudalistic structure into society. So a neo-feudalism, and also in a sense part of what some people call surveillance capitalism, which is basically run by huge companies, monopolies more or less. All that can be built, and even other kinds of societies too. Now, I'm not sure how many people got excited about these models of society. Yeah, not too many, no good effect. And so it's no wonder that now we're experiencing a tech clash, right? So people have realized what's going on, and they say, we deserve something better. We can use technology in a better way. And there's even criticism within the business world. So Tim Cook of Apple was criticizing Google and Facebook for their manipulation of customers, of users. Also the reputation of Google has a lot to criticize about what European telecommunication companies, for example, are doing with our data. John Parker from Facebook said that this company exploits a vulnerability in human psychology, and just recently the WhatsApp founders have said, we have sold the private sphere of our users. Also in a recent article, the rating that we do all the time now, implicitly and explicitly, that has features of totalitarianism. So this danger is all around. And some companies are responding. Apple chief Tim Cook said, we have decided ourselves to collect as little data as possible. Whatever that means is probably still a thousand times more than what we have in Switzerland, or at least ATM. Now, here is a new approach for Europe, maybe for the entire world. I think we should build our future society on collective intelligence and our economy on combinatorial innovation. And I will explain why. First of all, what should we do with all that data? So there are digital Googles of everything. We have to realize that. These are highly detailed, including all your economic, social, psychological, and partly also health features. So all of that has been collected by hundreds of thousands of companies, and let's realize that the Secret Service is putting all that data together. I think we should open up the value of this data for everyone, for our entire society. We should build a platform on top of this, which would allow us to control our own data. That means to decide which company would be allowed to use what kind of data for what purpose and period of time, and maybe for what payments too. That means all personalized services and products would be possible through all companies, including small and medium-sized companies, spin-off companies, also research institutions would have access to the data under one condition, that users agree to share the data for those purposes. But if they feel uncomfortable about a certain kind of data use or a certain kind of company, they can block it. Now, in order to make sure that we wouldn't have to spend 3 hours a day to administer all of our data, we would have AI-based digital assistants that basically know our preferences. And they would be on our computer or our smartphone and kind of pre-select the settings, and we could still change that. All the uses of our personal data would be reported to our data mailbox, so we could look into it and see what has been done with our data by whom research institutions and governments would be allowed to make statistics. So basically, you know, everyone would benefit from this. We could build it because there are global centers that collect a hell of a lot of data, such as this global cybersecurity center. And if we did that, we would really be able to empower people, such that every one of us could take better decisions, be more creative and innovative, support our cooperation and so on. That means businesses would benefit, cities would benefit, societies would benefit, we all would benefit, and all that would also enable combinatorial innovation. That means the combination of data, products, services, and what we have learned in the past with each other, such that new services and products and knowledge can be created. And so that is a model that would lead to not just exponential growth, but to factorial growth. That means if Europe would decide to go this way, which is in a sense, as Merkel said, a model which is between the American model and the Chinese model, the business, purely business-driven data model versus the purely government-driven data model. What I'm proposing is bringing it together and opens up the validation for everyone. So far, it's not decided who owns our data, right? So this can be realized. And Europe could actually catch up and overtake, but by the time, of course, all the other countries would engage into a similar strategy, right? So now, collective intelligence. I think also democracy can largely benefit from digital technology. But we see that democracies around the world are challenged by developments, not just by the digital transformation, also by economic transformation, by sustainability challenges, climate change, mass migration, and so on. Now, the point is, we should learn to bring the best ideas of many minds together, and that requires online deliberation platforms. Something better than Facebook and Twitter, obviously, right? But the main point about solving complex problems is that we need to look at them from different perspectives. A single perspective is never good enough. And also, a single best solution is not the best solution, it turns out, in many of these problems. That means if you combine the best individual solution with, say, the second best and the third best, you would usually get an even better solution. That is the secret of collective intelligence. And this is what building digital democracy is about, unleashing our knowledge, our ideas, our talents by combining it together in a collaborative way. And in fact, in a sense, there is practical proof that I'm right about it, because YouTube was actually trying to get rid of fake news by artificial intelligence. I mean, very intelligent bidders, in other words. And this approach failed. They couldn't get control of fake news, and then eventually Facebook decided that it would, oh, wait a moment. Oh, that's what I want to say. Okay, Facebook couldn't solve the fake news problem with AI, and then suddenly they decided they would use Wikipedia. And that is based on collective intelligence, right? So collective intelligence is more powerful, but now they have built a war room in advance of the elections, and apparently they still haven't really learned the lesson, because I think what they should have built is a peace room, right? And a peace room is actually something which would have more transparency, an ethical and democratic framework, and a multi-perspective approach, and also participatory opportunities. I mean, it would take its community on board to help increase the quality of information. Now, eventually, I think the digital revolution will allow us to address the world's existential problems. And we haven't talked enough about how we can use digital technology to solve climate change, or the financial economic spending crisis, conflict, mass migration, terrorism, and so on. All of that seems to me to be an outcome of lack of sustainability. That means overuse of resources in some places, while there's a lack of resources in other places, which creates conflict and war and all those troubles. And in fact, we should all know this, and the United Nations has come up with the United Nations Agenda 2030 Sustainable Development Goals in order to address those issues, whether it's just 13 or 12 in fact, years back left. So we're kind of in trouble. We have to speed up. And that's why I think, besides the Pillar 1, Nation States and United Nations, and Pillar 2 of solving global problems, which is global cooperation, we need a third pillar, which is networks of cities, where basically we could activate the potential of civil society. So these would be friendly competitions of cities for new solutions to important problems such as climate, energy, sustainability, resilience, and peace. And we have two workshops in Vienna in order to push this idea forward. This was all happening this year. In between those two workshops, the United States already was going forward, so this is what American First apparently means. So they have been incredibly fast, and in fact, the first competition is already happening this autumn. They have mobilized 70 million, so where is Europe again, you know? So we really have to push the gas in order to be part of it. So, the idea of City Olympics is to fix the world together. We all could make contribution to this huge transformation of our society towards a digital and sustainable society. I think politics alone or business alone cannot do. We need to get all people on board as much as that can be done. And so the idea is to basically extend the hackathon format that's working quite well and impressive from my point of view to a longer time period, say 6 months. And in this time, actually groups of people could come up with concepts that their city would bring up in the competition. And API is good at these kind of things. You know, we can build that stuff. It's really amazing what's happening at this institution. So these kind of solar driven cars could be built over here, self-driving cars. And one hacker built a self-driving car himself. You know, amazing. And probably not perfect, but still, you know, can get really far in this way. Or a new kind of planes and flying mobility solutions and so on and so on. And in fact, the United States decided they wanted to be a nation of makers. And traditional Europe has been strong in these disciplines too, building stuff, engineering, you know. But now we have to bring it into the digital age. In Amsterdam, for example, this is the makerspace. 400-year-old important historical building where this happened. We've all seen this painting. And so what they did hundreds of years back, they looked into people to learn how the human body works, and this spirit is still there. So now they're building things such as the fearful. Very impressive, and here you can really open this thing up, you can learn how it works, you can repair it, you can upgrade it, and all these kind of things. This has been built by the Amsterdam Fab Lab. Now, we have Fab Labs all around the world. I think the third one is by far not as impressive, but that can change, of course. And then citizen science is also along this kind of thinking of opening up science for everyone's contribution. So some problems can be solved best in this way, not even with machine learning, AI, and so on. That such protein folding problems can be efficiently solved, and people are surprisingly efficient at that. Or take OpenStreetMap, where now there are a million people contributing data to produce one of the most up-to-date street maps of the world, including hiking trails and all this. And in principle, you can do that also for a reconstruction of cities in 3D using all the photographs that people anyway upload to the internet, right? So why then not come up with participatory health services and also with responsible consumption platforms where we the people have a say and can be part of a co-creation process, but also participate with resilience. Now, one could go even a step further and engage into what people call open source urbanism, right? The point is principles on which Wikipedia and GitHub have been built and create comments. I would also be part of the City Olympics idea. The solutions would be open source for everyone to use. Every city could choose the solution that fits its budget best, its culture best, and could combine different solutions. So in this way, we could really make much faster progress together, again through combinatorial innovation. And this kind of thinking also now goes into the direction of open source hardware and even open source architecture and open source urban design and operation. And the basis of this would be openness, collaboration, modularity, granularity, and low cost integration. Now, maybe this is not as relevant for a country such as Switzerland as for developing countries. But now we feel the pressure of mass migration in many countries, and it seems like maybe it would be good to build livable cities in the countries where those people come from or close by. And the question is really, how could we make quick headway? And here I think open source urbanism could be a solution and could really tremendously accelerate the evolution of new city quarters and new cities and contribute to cities that we can co-create. And I think in the end we would also learn something from it and benefit. Now, you know Sebastian Kuhn, right? So that's where he got his honorary PhD at TU Delft. And he said, only 1% of all things have been invented. Of course, that's just a claim, but the point, of course, is yes, probably a lot of things can still be invented. And we're in a time where we have to be probably much more innovative in order to solve the world's problems in these 15, 20, 25, 30 years ahead. It's a very short time period, you know, it will be an enormous change. But only if we can unleash creativity and also have the tools to support collaboration between people, not only collaboration that's planned by cities and by companies, but that is based on bottom-up initiative and engagement. And how to make sure this would really reach a high level of quality? Well, this is where social computing comes in. In principle, we could have software that guides people who are not entrepreneurs by training to do all the things that need to be done in order to organize projects well and find the right people and do the right accounting, keeping time planning, and so on and so on. Augmented reality and mixed reality, I think, can really offer entirely new solutions over here. We're living in a time where robots, through transmission of knowledge through robot clouds, would learn immediately. When a robot, say, in Japan has learned a new trick, a robot of the same kind of family in the United States or South Korea would know how to use that trick. Well, humans are going to school for 13, 12, 13 years, and then they go study 5 years and do a PhD and then they specialize. You know, this is slow. So, I mean, we need to have these new kind of approaches which make knowledge that has been created in any place of the world immediately available to any other human being. And just for the sake of fairness, we need to open up knowledge not just for robots, but for everyone like us. And what we really need to solve is this sustainability problem. Today, we're producing a lot of waste, 50 tons in a lifetime. And politics is trying to solve the problem and create a circular economy through regulations and laws, but this is a very slow process. Here is another idea. Let's use the Internet of Things that we also carry an effect in our pockets in order to measure noise and other externalities, stress and CO2 and all the garbage that's being produced and the environmental impact and the positive things too, like knowledge, education, quality of life, new jobs, reuse of resources and so on. And so with the Internet of Things, this can be cheaply measured right now. And number one principle would be to increase positive externalities once we know about it, reduce negative ones, and ensure fair compensation. And to build a multi-dimensional real-time feedback system that can now be built, for example, with blockchain technology. And it would create new forces in the markets. So, for example, garbage, say, equipped with some sensors, would basically create forces that would pull it to places where it would be reused. And in this way, a circular economy would eventually emerge through these new forces and incentive systems, and sharing economy would, of course, circular economy. We are also trying to make a small contribution to this, so we've had the second pilots, it means blockchain and Internet of Things schools, and the students were amazingly engaged and had a lot of projects from financial markets to environment to democracy to energy. You know, you can do so many things, and it's really amazing what ETNR students are doing in just a week's time. So now, where to head? I think we like to live in a world that is digitally assisted, but that gives us freedoms to decide our paths. And in principle, the idea is society would work such as a flock of birds, or at the moment that's not yet happening, but it could be made to happen with the Internet of Things. And in fact, I will show you a few examples that we have been working on ourselves. Cars, of course, are getting smarter and smarter with all those sensors that, in a sense, have perception. It could be also communication between cars, something that we could call cognition of the traffic state and decision making, how to respond to the situation. In fact, with that kind of technology, we can change traffic flow in a decentralized way. So here you see a computer simulation that shows these annoying stop-and-go waves that we still have every day. We wouldn't need to have them. But first we need to understand, why do we have this problem? So we'll leave this car, we'll take a helicopter, and we'll shortly see that the problem is that there is an on-ramp. And so some cars are trying to get on the freeway. That produces small disruptions of the flow. Those disruptions are being amplified, and that causes the stop and go traffic flow. Now assume that we would equip the cars, or at least say 20-30% of them, with radar sensors or other sensors to measure the distance and relative velocity, and based on that information, cars would accelerate and decelerate in a slightly different way from what humans would do, and you can see the traffic jam disappears, even though the same number of cars are trying to enter the freeway. How have we made this happen? Well, this is called mechanism design. We're changing the interaction mechanism. And using real-time measurements, real-time data, real-time feedback to change the interaction. That success principle can also be used to improve traffic flow in urban spaces. So, for example, you can see here self-organized green waves that occur based on a principle that we've learned from self-organizing pedestrian flows and bottlenecks. So you can see here is an oscillatory flow happening. And the pressure principle that produces those as oscillatory flows can be used to define the traffic line control. So the traffic flows in our approach are controlling the traffic lights rather than the other way around. Now the question, how well does this work? Let's compare three different ways of operating cities. This is the classical way. So we would have a control center that collects as much data as possible from all over the city and tries to come up with an optimal plan and impose it on the entire city. The problem is, it's an NP-hard optimization problem that cannot be solved in real time, and so you need to make simplifications, and basically an optimal plan is created for typical traffic flows, say Monday morning between 10 and 11, Friday afternoon between 4 and 5, and so on. And then this is being adjusted, but still you have a circular periodic operation with some variables. Now, this second thing assumes that every intersection was separately trying to minimize travel times of those cars approaching that intersection. That means each intersection operates separately, tries to do the very best job, like Homo economicus. But we would think that should be better because that's essentially controlled and coordinated. And here the third approach would be like the second, but if there's a long two of the vehicles that would be cleared before we go back to travel time minimization. So this is a friendly approach towards your neighbor intersections, but friendliness would pay off. This more selfish thing should work better, and that should be the best. Okay, let's see what really happens. The red line shows you how top-down regulation performs. It's a function of the capacity utilization of the intersection. Queue length increases as traffic volume increases, and that makes a lot of sense. Now, here you see what happens if homo economicus at each intersection is at work. Much better over here at small traffic volumes, because you don't have to wait until the green light comes up in a periodic way. So it will be switched green for you. But over here you see suddenly queue length explodes, and basically we can say that Adam Smith's invisible hand works over here, but it really fails miserably over there, and that's why the traffic control center says, yes, that's why you have us, and that's why you pay millions for us to work for you. But what happens with the third approach? Now, the surprise is it works better all the way, because it's flexible and it has a self-organized coordination mechanism between those neighboring intersections. And so this approach makes the invisible hand work in a decentralized way, right? So bottom-up optimization can outsmart optimal top-down control. Now the question is, what happens in reality if you have a city center such as that in Dresden, which is really not at all a Manhattan road network, but much more complicated, frustrating to the traffic authorities, and they would love to prioritize public transportation. Of course, there are so many trams and buses, but they cannot do it because they need to have a greenway. This is what their expensive state-of-the-art control is producing. So adaptive greenways, but if you interrupt this to prioritize a tram or a bus, it will destroy the greenway and will create a monster traffic jam within just minutes, right? Well, we came up with a possibility that creates self-organized greenways. They're not so periodic, not so regular, but let's see how the performance is in the end. Well, our approach can largely reduce delay time for public transport, as expected, but not at the cost of motorized individualized traffic. So they also have a little benefit. And pedestrian and cyclists also benefit a lot, and the environment too. So new approach for NP-hard optimization problems based on real-time data, real-time feedback. Now the question is, can we do that also for society, right? And Eleanor Ostrom, the Nobel Prize winner, said, well, self-governance can be efficient if we just have proper design principles. But what are proper design principles? Now, this is what we need to learn, right? Because there are tragedies of the commons, such as exploitation of our environment and pollution and climate change and all these kind of things. But there are actually a number of decentralized mechanisms that promote cooperation and social order and overcome tragedies of the commons. And we can choose. I mean, one of them is genetic favoritism, maybe not the best mechanism to choose. Direct reciprocity, so basically friendship formation, sounds much more plausible to us. Probably peer punishment, well, who wants to be punished, but at least it works to establish norms. Question is it the most efficient way to establish cooperation? The answer is no. There is also a certain kind of communication techniques where it's costly communication, right? If you have cheap information, you have cheap talk. So think about this, and that could be a valuable element for better social media platforms. And also, if you have merit-based matching, that means if cooperative people would preferentially interact with corporate people. This would not only benefit them, but also create incentive for the other people to become more cooperative. Then also, reputation systems actually are quite efficient in improving the level of quality, as long as, of course, reputation scores cannot be manipulated. And being at ETHs, also say qualification is another mechanism. So if you show that you're using data and algorithms in responsible ways, yes, you should get access to more data and more functionality. And if you misuse that stuff, you should have probably less data volume, less the functionality at hand. So in other words, social dilemmas can be overcome by all sorts of mechanisms that can, in principle, be built into digital platforms. Just Facebook and Twitter apparently know too little about how society works and the social mechanisms that could help them increase cooperation, fairness, trust, and truth in the digital world. Now, in principle, one could build something like a digital gene that helps us in all kinds of situations of life, right? In particular, if we think about super intelligent systems, creating those citizen scores is one way of using that kind of technology. It basically comes up with a list of sins, and then you'd be punished for every sin that you did wrong. And I think it's a terrible idea to run a society in this way. And instead, we could run society in a different way and say, this digital genie, yeah, that somehow is around us, it listens to us, yeah, knows what we want, we need a car, 5 minutes to go to work or whatever, we bring the car to our door. All these kind of things could be happening in a more or less automated way. And the point is, now, what should such a super intelligent system support? Well, probably not selfishness. It should support cooperation, it should support caring for the environment, it should support doing good things. So basically, you know, we could build digital systems that provide digital, say, superpowers for those people who do good to other people, to society, and to the environment. And that would be a totally different approach of using artificial intelligence to improve the world. So it would be good for this to distinguish different kinds of cases that can occur. So when two people interact with each other, there could be situations where both of them would experience losses. These kinds of situations need to be avoided. People need to be warned and protected from this. There could be win-win situations. People could be made aware of those opportunities, so they take those chances really. Today, most likely, many chances are not taken at all. There could be win-lose situation where one person would win, but the other person would lose. But through a value transfer from one to the other, one could create a win-win situation. So also that could be supported by digital technology. And finally, there could be bad win-lose situations where one person would have incentives to exploit the other person, and you would want to protect that other person from exploitation. So in principle, AI systems could really help improve the outcome of interaction. For sure, we're in the middle of a major transformation of our society, maybe the biggest society human history has ever seen. It will be a new kind of game that we're playing, a new society that's working according to different rules. Now, we have to think about those rules now and decide it collectively and implement it. And I think the success principles of the future complex digital world would be co-learning, co-creation, combinatorial innovation, coordination, cooperation, co-evolution, and collective intelligence. And so these be a game changer. Thank you.